On April 22, 2024, a massive fire broke out at the Ghazipur landfill site in Delhi. This was no ordinary fire, but a symptom of a much larger problem. Ghazipur was supposed to have been shut down in 2002. Instead, authorities reportedly kept sending up to 700 truckloads of trash there every day. It has piled up almost as high as the Taj Mahal. When waste decomposes, it releases methane, a highly flammable gas. So not really surprising that the whole thing burst into flames. But methane is also a super potent greenhouse gas that drives global warming. And as our mountains of trash keep growing, more and more of it is seeping out of the countless waste sites around the world. But there are ways to stop this. Food scraps, plastic bottles, pizza boxes. Think about how many things you throw away each day. Depending on how and where you live, this might differ a lot. The average Indian tosses out 500 grams of garbage every day. For the average American, it's 2.2 kilos. By the way, the US is the world champion in waste generation per capita. This pile grows along with cities and the rising standard of living. This was part of the problem in Ghazipur. In 1984, when the landfill first opened, Delhi's population was not even 7 million. Now it is about 34 million. The authorities weren't ready for that. And on the planet right now, we're 8 billion people producing 2.1 billion tons of rubbish every year. According to this UN study, 38% ends up where it shouldn't. Some 2.7 billion people lack access to basic waste management services.
So no collection, no treatment, no disposal.
Aditi Ramola is the technical director at the International Solid Waste Association. She's one of the supervisors of this study.
So for the lack of those options, what do people end up doing? They take their waste, they start to burn or dump it or dig a hole and dump their waste there. And so this is leading to a crisis.
There's no precise number for how many such dump sites there are on the planet, but each one is one too many. And it is important to distinguish here between dump sites and landfills.
They are very different things. A dump site is where there is absolutely no environmental control.
When it rains, the water filters through the waste and forms leachate, a potentially toxic cocktail of many heavy chemicals and bacteria, among other things, that soak out of the trash.
It's leaking into the environment, either through your waterways, your soils, or your air, by open burning. And so all of these are emissions that are ending up in the environment that are harming human health, it's harming the environment. When I talk about human health, essentially, if you have contaminated waste, it's going into our food systems.
Under this mountain of trash where there is no oxygen, something else is happening. Bacteria are breaking down organic waste and producing methane, one of the worst greenhouse gases. In the short term, it's over 80 times more potent at hitting the planet than carbon dioxide. The waste sector accounts for 3 to 5% of all greenhouse gas emissions. Dump sites and landfills are the biggest contributors. And there are the sanitary landfills, which have more environmental controls that try to mitigate all those problems. They started to evolve in the 20th century, especially in the second half, also because the material used in our products have become much more toxic to the natural environment. Currently, the United States has more than 2,600 landfills. That's a lot of trash. Americans have historically relied on landfills for many reasons. Just to name a few, consumption levels are really high, the country has wide open spaces available, and using landfill was quite often seen as the cheapest option in the short term. That is why half of the trash produced by Americans ends up there. So it's no wonder that they host the planet's biggest landfill of its kind, according to the Guinness World Records, the Apex landfill, outside of Las Vegas. It's big enough to accept waste for the next 250 years. Landfill operators use several ways to tackle the problems of dumping trash. To protect the ground from toxic chemicals, they start with a large hole in the ground lined with giant impermeable layers of synthetic material, kind of like a huge empty swimming pool with a big plastic sheet in it. At the bottom, there's a drainage system to remove the leachate that's generated. Sensors can also be placed at the bottom layer to detect any possible leaks. After the leachate is treated, it is turned into reusable water. Nowadays, an engineered landfill can also capture most of the methane emitted, by making a kind of trash lasagna that stops most of it from going to the atmosphere. As the garbage is dumped, heavy tractors compact it and then cover it with an impermeable layer. Dump, compact, cover, repeat, over and over again. Then a kind of system of pumps sucks out most of the gases generated, including the methane. At this point, there are two options. The methane captured can be burned through a process called flaring that turns it from a super harmful greenhouse gas into a regular harmful one, CO2. But this is a huge waste. Here comes the second option. Methane can generate heat, electricity, or renewable natural gas and power vehicles, for example. Many US landfills use these technologies, and even here in the media that altogether they produce enough equivalent energy to power 1 million homes. This technique promises to reduce methane emissions by 60 to 90%. So, problem solved? Not quite. Using special infrared cameras on planes and satellites, researchers have detected substantial leaks. Current measuring methods, which usually rely on ground observations, couldn't detect them. The researchers found that US landfills emit 1.4 times more methane than officially reported. But it's not all bad news. This data can help landfill managers to detect leaks and reduce emissions straight away. However, not all solutions in this field need to be so high-tech. The IPCC's recommendation to reduce methane emissions from landfill is much simpler and more straightforward. Reduce the amount of organic waste in them, because the methane emissions from landfills are produced when organic matter decomposes underneath a pile of garbage without oxygen.
If we had taught our younger generation that waste is not waste, it is a resource, probably this situation would not have arrived.
This is Sharad Kale, a scientist who specializes in waste management in India.
Being a warm environment, our environment is very good for degradation of the material. So if you do it in a scientific way, in a structured manner, I think we can actually stop the methane emission need.
In countries like India, where around 50% of the garbage is wet waste, avoiding it in landfills can be really effective. And some places are being quite successful in implementing this policy. Take Mysuru, for example. With a population of more than 1 million, it produces between 400 and 500 tons of waste daily. The authorities designed a decentralized system in which trash gets collected, segregated, and composted inside their neighborhoods. Here it is important to remember that composting is primarily an aerobic process with oxygen, where microorganisms break down organic matter. It can release small amounts of methane if it's not properly done, if there isn't enough aeration. That is why quite often you see people turning the compost regularly. In Mysuru, about 50% of all waste is composted. For that, the collector goes from door to door. If residents don't properly separate their trash, they'll be fined. Officials say only 5% of the trash goes to landfill. Their goal is zero waste.
Zero waste management is like no waste should go to the plant or a landfill to the incineration plant. So we are completely managing the waste which are receiving from different wards of Mysore City Corporation.
The compost produced is sold to local farmers and the horticulture department. When you look around India, this may feel like a drop in the ocean, but it is a great example that shows it can be done. Composting also sorts out another huge problem. Almost one-third of the country's farmland suffers from soil degradation, partly due to the heavy use of chemical fertilizers. Now, organic compost is being used on farms to restore the land. This is a great example of climbing up the ladder of the waste hierarchy. At the very bottom of it is the worst possible way to get rid of trash, open burning or dumping. That is where the wet waste we just saw would probably end up. Then comes disposal without energy recovery, like kinds of landfilling or incineration. Next is waste to energy, which is an umbrella term for a few different methods, like the US landfills we saw generate electricity out of methane. Here comes recycling. This is where the composting examples are. Even better is to reuse things, often referred to as upcycling. And at the top of it is prevention and reduction. That part depends a lot on waste producers, so companies as well as individual consumers. Going up in the pyramid is not always easy. Closing dump sites and making landfill better is a challenge and can be a long process, but it can be done. Like in Rio de Janeiro, It once hosted Latin America's biggest dump site, Jardim Gramacho, which received over 80 million tons of garbage in 30 years. The surrounding mangrove forest was devastated by its leachate.
Então, a partir de 1997, foi feita uma barreira que coleta esse chorume. O chorume é tratado e só depois é lançado na Baía de Guanabara.
Mario Moscatelli is the biologist responsible for this restoration project.
Então, nesses 30 e poucos anos de trabalhos quase que contínuos, nós recuperamos a maior área de manguezal da Baía de Guanabara, que são 130 hectares de mangue.
The mangrove forest captures a huge amount of CO2. This kind of vegetation can absorb up to 4 times more carbon than other forests. And now, Rio's waste goes to a modern landfill outside of the city. The site captures most of its methane emissions. According to the operator, it generates enough energy to power a city of 90,000 residents. It is a modern engineered landfill, which costed around $90 million. But that doesn't mean that the problem is solved. In nearby Gramacho, there are still illegal dump sites. And even in the restoration project itself, there were problems with leaking leachate in 2014, which now seems to have been sorted. This approach isn't cheap and it's not perfect, but it does have a lot of potential. Look at this graphic. It shows regions that still have a huge number of open dump sites. In this case, some experts suggest that moving from dump sites to landfills would already be a step forward. On the top of that, separating at least the organic trash before sending it to the landfill, like in Mysuru, is something we can do on a global level. Of course, reducing waste is the top priority that can also be reached worldwide and is placed at the top of the pyramid. But let's face it, right now we're producing more and more trash worldwide. The power of smart waste management is that it can reduce costs in the long run. The higher up in the waste pyramid you go, the more money you can make from the trash, such as by making energy or reselling trash as compost. And the more waste you collect in a controlled way, the less harm it does to the environment, and the less money is needed to clean up this mess. What about you? Do you have any problems with dump sites or landfills nearby where you live? Any cool solutions around? Let us know in the comments below. Hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos for you every Friday.